My name is Tomasz Wawrzyniak. I work at the Institute of Geophysics, Polish Academy of Sciences, at the Department of Polar and Marine Research. And for the last 15 years, I've been traveling to Svalbard doing scientific and also educational projects. So it's been a few years, and for the last 10 years, I've been coordinating the hydrometeorological monitoring that is conducted at the Polish Polar Station Hornsund in Svalbard. And this is something that I will show you during the presentation. And I'm gonna also introduce you to Arctic hydrology, because that's the main topic of today's lecture that I'm gonna give. So let me just share my presentation first. Yeah. So we're gonna go briefly through different aspects of hydrological cycle, just to let you know how it looks. The lecture will include information on the terminology of hydrology, also about the measurements, the equipment that we use in Svalbard, and I'm gonna also show you some actually multiple results of my scientific measurements and the papers that I published in the past. The most important thing I want to say is that water is unique and it covers 71% of the surface of planet Earth. It also nourishes every human, plant, and animal cell, and it also plays a major role in the complex processes in climate system of planet Earth. So it's vital for every life that appears on planet Earth. It is only the only one known substance that naturally exists in gas, liquid, and solid form. So as ice, water, and water vapor. So water vapor is gas, liquid is water, and solid it's ice. And it appears in small range of air temperatures and pressures that are found at the Earth's surface. So it's pretty important to know. That's why it's so unique. And I mentioned that there is also water cycle. Water cycle describes the movement of water molecules within the Earth's atmosphere system. And it's continuous, it's ongoing. There's no start or end of this cycle. So it works like that, that the liquid water evaporates from the oceans, lakes, rivers, and streams, and also from the land surface. Then it rises into the atmosphere as water vapor, and then it can condense and form clouds and come back to the Earth's surface again as precipitation, such as rainfall, snowfall, drizzle, or different forms of the precipitation that comes down from the atmosphere to the Earth. But what is Arctic hydrology? It includes multiple processes. For example, groundwater discharge to the ocean, all the processes that happen in the ocean. It's also measurement of the floating sea ice, the temperatures of the ocean itself, also the salinity. As hydrologist, I also deal with the runoff from the land, so how much water goes on surface and also from groundwater, and also how much water is stored in form of snow or ice. And it's also all the atmospheric dynamics, all the processes that happen in the atmosphere, formation of clouds, and also precipitation. So the Arctic hydrology is the scientific study of the water movement and distribution, that means water cycles, and also management. So as hydrologist, I also try to measure and calculate how much water is stored and what's the water resource for this particular area, the Arctic. Of course, water cycle is powered by the energy from the sun, and it's continuous. And this picture, I think it shows how it works. So you can see the water vapor that evaporates from the ocean surface, then it's uplifted to the atmosphere. And if there are special conditions for that, it can condense and form clouds. And then from clouds, it can fall down in liquid form or solid form as rain or snow. So that was the picture of the water cycle as a scheme, and this is the picture that shows the process in the nature. The water has also multiple consequences for Earth's climate and all ecosystems. It has the capacity to store large amounts of heat, and this heat can be transported to vast distances. For example, in the Arctic, there is one of the currents that goes from the south to the north. It's part of Gulf Stream, and it brings relatively warm water into the far north. In the surroundings of the Svalbard archipelago, there is warm West Spitsbergen current that flows along the western coast. And there is also cold current that comes down from the Arctic Ocean to the south. And it usually brings lots of drift ice that makes the eastern parts of the archipelago colder with much heavier ice conditions. In the solid form, ice is less dense than liquid water, so it can float on the surface of water, and it insulates the water that is underneath. So this prevents the complete freezing of bodies of water. Whenever it's a small pond or the Arctic Ocean, this insulates the effect of cold temperatures that are above and allows life to nourish underneath the water. So sea ice also sustains life through the harshest of winters. If you think about the Arctic, in the heart of the Arctic, there is Arctic Ocean that is covered by floating sea ice, as you can see on this satellite image. It's surrounded by continents of Eurasia and North America, and there are also multiple islands and also archipelagos. The biggest island is, of course, Greenland, but there's, for example, Svalbard archipelago located here. And this is the place where I go quite often. I just came back 3 weeks ago from Svalbard, and in 3 weeks I'm gonna go again to install all the equipment to measure the runoff from rivers that soon will start to flow again after complete freezing of during the winter. The sea ice in the Arctic changes its range, so it means it expands and then retreats. It extends when the temperatures are cold, so during winter and spring. And this is the period when it has the maximum extent. It's usually between February and March. And then it has its minimum in September and October. So during winter, it can have the area of around 15 million square kilometers. So it's 1.5 size of Europe. And during summer, it melts, and the minimum extent is around 6 million square kilometers. And this is something that we know from the satellite images. These have been done for many years, since the 70s of the 20th century. So the satellite images provide information what's the extent of the sea ice. And from that, we know what are the consequences of the climate change, because we see that every decade, the amount that disappears, the amount of the floating ice that disappears is around minus 30% in 10 years. So it's much less than it was in the 70s. It's thinner, so it's not as thick as it was in the past. And also the extent it shrinks, it's smaller than in the past. So for example, here you can see the average for the years 1981 and 2010 on the left. So on the average, it was 6.3 million square kilometers in September. And then year 2020, 3.7 million square kilometers. The sea ice in the Arctic is very important. Its disappearance has enormous consequences for oceanic and atmospheric circulation. So what happens in the Arctic influences also the lower latitudes, also in Poland, also in Romania. What we see recently, there are more floods and more droughts, because the hot air masses can travel from the south to the north because the Arctic is not as cold as it was in the past. And the reduction of snow and ice in the Arctic has the effect of increasing warming. Because, for example, once you wear white t-shirt during summer or during such a sunny day as today, you know that some of the heat will be, the solar radiation will be reflected from white t-shirt, and it will be absorbed by the black t-shirt. So it's, once the surface is darker, the more solar radiation will be absorbed. So if there is less snow and ice, the more solar radiation is absorbed by land and also by the ocean. And that's why in the Arctic, we see this warming that is really dramatic. And we see the huge retreat of glaciers, less sea ice, and also multiple other factors that we observe. For example, permafrost is disappearing. We also observe there is less snow cover, and the temperatures are higher and higher. And that's something that I'm going to show you using the data from our station in Hornsund. The solar energy drives evaporation. So the water that evaporates from oceans, also from open surface water, such as lakes, rivers, and also from the soils and water sources. Evaporation occurs when the surface is exposed. That means, for example, once you have a bottle that is closed, so the water is not exposed to the atmosphere, it won't evaporate. It will stay inside the bottle. And this is what happens with the deeper groundwater that is not exposed to the surface. But once there is connection between the atmosphere and the water, so for example, from the lakes, from the rivers, from the oceans, from land, there will be evaporation. And there is another process called transpiration. That's the process of movement of water through plants. So it moves from the roots through leaves, stems, and flowers, and then it also evaporates. So both of these processes are called evapotranspiration. That's something that we use in hydrology. And studies indicate that the ocean, seas, and land-based bodies of water provide nearly 90% via evaporation. 10% is evapotranspiration, and less than 1% is sublimation. So the process by which water changes directly from a solid form into a gas, into water vapor. That's sublimation, without liquid form in between. But how to measure evaporation? For that, for example, in Hornsund, we use evaporometers. And you can see on the images, that's the balance on top of which there is a bowl with water. And we measure the weight of this water that is in this bowl. And from that, we have information how much water was evaporated, because it disappears. It has to be refilled once in 2 weeks, or depending on the, weather conditions. With the higher air temperatures, there will be higher evaporation. And here is some data from multiple evaporometers that we installed last year in 2022 in Hornsund surroundings. And water vapor, the really important thing about that is the dominant greenhouse gas that accounts for more than 60% of the global greenhouse effect. If a volume of air contains a maximum amount of water vapor and the temperature is decreased, so the higher we go, the lower the temperature. So the water vapor will condense at some level above the Earth's surface. And this is where the clouds can be formed. So these clouds form as warm air containing water vapor rises and cools down at higher altitudes. And this water condenses into small droplets that can make clouds. They can grow, they can also form crystals. So for example, snow crystals. And for clouds to form, the two most important ingredients are necessary. First, there must be moisture present in the atmosphere. And there also must be atmospheric particles, the tiny ones called aerosols. So this can be some parts of dust that travel in the atmosphere. This can be seeds of some plants around which the water vapor can condense and form drops, and then form clouds. And this, if the droplets are big enough, they can come down as precipitation. Here are some examples of clouds. So once these raindrops are produced, or are ice crystals, if these are large enough, there will be not enough energy to push them up. So they will fall down as precipitation and continue the water cycle. So once the advection is not strong enough, the particles are too big to hold them, there will be rainfall or snowfall. And here are some examples of that. On the left, you can see the virga process. Once there is precipitation, but this precipitation doesn't reach the ground. So it falls down from the cloud, but never reaches the surface of the earth. So that it's called virga. It's sometimes visible from these clouds. And on the right, you have image taken during snowfall. It was pretty strong snowfall. How to measure precipitation? For that, we use pluviometers. These are rain gauges, the instruments that are used by hydrologists at the meteorological sites. And these provide data on gathered and measured amount of precipitation. So into these gauges, there is snowfall and rainfall that is collected, and then it is measured. So to the left, you can see the classical Hellman rain gauge. And to the right, there are two different laser one. It's called Parsifal, and the other one is called Geonor. It's also balanced, that measures automatically how much snowfall or rainfall there was. In the surroundings of the Hornsund station, there are around 250 days with snow cover per year. So there, it's much more than in Poland or in Romania. Maybe in the upper parts of the Carpathians, we can see that there is snow accumulated for a similar period of time. And in surroundings of Hornsund, in upper parts of the glaciers, there can be even meters of snow that is accumulated on upper parts of the glaciers in the accumulation zone. And that's something that is measured also by us during spring. And when the maximum accumulation appears, it's usually in April. And then we go back to the same locations in September to check how much snow was stored from the previous year or how much was melted. And this is the information that is necessary to know what's the mass balance of the glaciers. And that's the part of glaciology that we're also dealing with. We also compared the data on snow cover. So, for example, at Hornsund station, you can see on the chart, the lower left panel, the green line shows that in the beginning of the 80s, there were around 250, 260 days with snow cover. And recently, we observe less than 250. That's around minus 10 days per decade. So that means that in the 80s of the 20th century, the snow cover lasted much longer, 1.5 months longer than recently. And that's also one of the factors, one of the indicators of the climate change. We also observe there is higher precipitation, but this precipitation comes as rain, mainly during autumn. And that's something that also influences how much snow and ice is stored after the previous year on the glacier, because when there is more water that appears on the glaciers, there will be more negative mass balance, because the rain, the water will melt the snow and ice, also making the shrinkage of the glaciers. We also compared the data from the air temperatures. On the left, you can see the chart that shows air temperatures during different months from January to December. In the years 1979-2019, the 80s, so 40 years ago, is shown by blue lines. The most recent lines are the red, And you can see on the chart that in the past, the temperatures in January, February, also in December, were around minus 12. And recently, we observed something around minus 6 degrees. And there is also a slight difference during summer. So there is higher temperature during summer, but not as much bigger as during autumn and also in winter. So this is the the biggest change we observe during winter months, not during summer. So this is during polar night. Probably you know that in far north, there is polar night and polar day. And here is precipitation. So that's something that I also mentioned. There is higher liquid precipitation, so more rainfall during autumn. The snow and ice profoundly affect our climate. During the Northern Hemisphere winter, they blanket up to 16% of the Earth's surface in the Northern Hemisphere. With this, that brings a bright cover that reflects so much, very much of the solar energy that comes in, the solar radiation is reflected. So once there is snow cover on the ground or on the ice, floating ice on the sea surface, the energy will be reflected back. If there is less snow cover, less ice, then more will be absorbed, as I already mentioned. And there are places on planet Earth where there is so much snowfall and the temperatures are so low that the snow can be stored. So it can be accumulated, and this if this accumulation is greater than the seasonal melting during summer, it can be accumulated and form thick snow cover. And with the pressure from the next layers, it can push away the air, and this is how the glacier ice is produced. So in high altitudes and high latitudes, there are glaciers. So you can expect glaciers in the Arctic, in Antarctic, and also in the highest mountains of planet Earth. Ice sheets and glaciers are very important reservoirs for fresh water. So, for example, 75% of fresh water is stored, and within this 75%, 91% of it is stored as Antarctic ice sheet, and 8% is Greenland ice sheet. And the remaining glaciers are around 1%. If you see the image of the glacier, you may think it's solid, it stays there, but it's actually in continuous movement. It moves continuously from higher to lower ground. Once you see the image that I took in September, you can see that the upper parts are covered with the snow from previous season, from previous winter, and this is accumulation zone. In lower parts, all the snow from previous year is melted, and there is also ice that was melted. So this is ablation zone. In between, there is equilibrium line altitude. So the altitude above which more snow was stored and below which more snow was ablated, disappeared from the snow, from the glacier cover. Once you compare how much snow is accumulated in the ablation zone and how much was melted in the ablation zone, you can get the information on the glacial budget. If the accumulation is higher than the ablation, the glacier will grow. Once the ablation is higher and the accumulation is smaller, the glacier will shrink. Of course, it's natural process of shrinking of the glacier during summer, but in recent years, we observed the accumulation zones are smaller and smaller, and there's not enough snow to provide enough material for the glacier to grow. So we observed the retreat of the glaciers, not only in Hornsund surroundings, not only in Svalbard, but across the globe. And this is also the one of main indicators of the climate change. Once the water appears on the surface of the ice, it can flow on the surface. it can accumulate and percolate in the accumulation area. So once the rainfall comes into the snow cover, it will infiltrate, it means percolate through the snow and firm down to ice layer, and then it can flow on the ice surface. It can reach even the terminus of the glacier, the end of the glacier, but it usually flows through the veins that make network of englacial channels. So there are different channels inside the glacier, and but there are also channels on top of the glacier and also underneath the glacier. So you can see that the veins that transport the water are pretty complex, and usually glaciers have very complex hydrological channels of the water that go through them, that goes through them. And at the bed, it can go through the tunnels. And here you can see, for example, once the water appears on the surface, and if there are crevasses, the water won't flow down, jumping over the crevasse. It will fall down into the crevasse. And this is where the channels are created. So the water is then transported inside the glacier. So once you go on the glacier, you need the special equipment, for example, crampons and all the equipment for helping yourself once you may fall into the crevasse. But once you are prepared, you can really go visit the glaciers inside, especially once it is frozen, so there's no water flowing through it in spring or late winter. And during summer, it's not possible to go inside the glacial tunnels because the tunnels are filled with water. So only the equipment can go there, but no human. And here you can see on the images, there are supraglacial streams. So the streams that flow on the surface of the glacier. There can be also englacial tunnels inside and subglacial streams that flow under the glacier. So these are three images that show these tunnels. And there are also moulins. So these are potholes where surface melt water exploits the weakness of the ice and drops into such a moulin. And these moulins can reach also the bed of the glacier. But once you have equipment, you can do the exploration of the glaciers and you can see where the channels go and also how the crystals are formed and how the layers of the ice look inside the glacier. Once the glacier terminates in the sea, so it's called tidewater glacier, there will be process of calving. And calving is natural process when the huge glaciers go into the sea, the huge chunks of ice will fall down into the water, and this process is called calving. So this zone where the calving appears in the terminus of the glacier is not pretty safe. It's better to keep away from it because one cubic meter of ice can weigh around 900 kilograms. So we can imagine what's the mass of the, you know, these chunks of ice that fall into the water. This on the image to the left, you can see it's around 40 meters above the water level. But they can also calve from underneath the water because it's not that it's not terminating in on the land. It terminates in the sea. So it means that underneath at some depth, there will be this foot of the glacier and there can be also calving of this foot. So it can calve also from underneath the water. So it's better not to go close to the front of the glacier. But that's something that we also deal with. And that's something that was published just a few days ago. If you're interested in the response of tidewater glacier termini positions in Hornsund Fjord to climate forcing in the last 30 years, you can read about that in our recent paper. In the past, we also described how the position of Hansbrenn was changing in the past years. But that's something that you can find in scientific papers that we produce. I mentioned about, for example, Hansbrenn, the glacier that terminates in the sea. That's the one to the south, in the lower corner of the image. But as you can see on the picture, there are also glaciers that terminate on land. And once they terminate on land, The meltwater will create the streams and the glacial rivers. So that's something that we also measure as hydrologists. We measure the runoff of those rivers. So the water in the Arctic that fell as rain or melted from snow flows via different paths before it reaches the ocean. It may go through the channels, it may go underneath the ground as subsurface water. And on the landscape, fresh water is stored in rivers, lakes, reservoirs, creeks, or streams. But there's also groundwater that is not visible from the surface. And that's something that we also measure using piezometers. So we have pipes that go into the ground. And in these pipes, there are holes that allow water to flow through. And this is how we measure what's the water level of groundwater. If you can, once you travel through the glacial rivers, they bear a lot of sediments. So the water is not as clean as comes from the ice and snow itself, because there's also multiple materials that are taken away. And for example, on these images, you can see that it's not possible to see the bottom of the river. So it may be tricky to go across those rivers. And there is also a possibility of change of the water level, because during, even though if it's a polar day, during night, the sun is above the horizon, but it's lower, so the temperature will be lower. And during the day, once the sun goes higher, the temperatures will be higher and the melt of the glaciers will be also higher. So the water level of the glacial rivers changes dramatically. It will be huge difference between the morning and between the afternoon. And here you can see the same river, the picture that was taken in the afternoon to the left, and to the right, it stayed in the early morning. The active hydrological cycle of rivers in Svalbard is relatively short. These rivers start to flow in June, and in the end of September, they start to freeze, and they freeze over during the winter, because these are not great big rivers as in Siberia. In Svalbard, the rivers are smaller, and once there is not enough water amount that is coming out of the subsurface or from the glaciers or from the rainfall, that during winter when the temperatures are low, these rivers freeze over. So there is no runoff during winter. But recently we observe longer period of the activity of these rivers. And that's something that we calculate using our measurements of the runoff. So what we want to know is the water balance, and that's the flow of water in and out of the system. So we want to know what's the amount of precipitation, what's the storage in snow and ice, and what's the runoff in the Arctic rivers. And for water balance, there is this basic equation that is very general. P is precipitation, so P equals runoff plus evapotranspiration, plus the change in water storage. So for example, for my projects in the past and also recently, I dealt with water balance in one of the catchments, Fugle Becken, as shown on the map. And when I say catchment, is the upstream area above which the all water flows down into the gauging point. So here is the boundary is drawn by the red line, and from this area, the water flows into the particular point where we do the measurements. So once we do the measurements in one point where the river goes, flows through, we know that it collects all the water that is from catchment above. Surface runoff can be caused by multiple processes. Under normal condition, only subsurface flow contributes to stream, but there's different characteristics, different topography that can then determine the amount of discharge. And in our case, also if there is glacier or if there is no glacier, it will influence how much water is going away from the catchment, so how much the runoff is changing. And the grayish line, for example, is the amount of water that flows out of the glaciated catchment. And here you can see the high variation of the amount of water that changes during the particular days, in the morning and in the afternoon. Once there is no glacier, the runoff will be more stable. How to measure the runoff in the rivers? So for that, we use multiple techniques. One of them can be classical subsection of the channel. So for that, we need to measure the depth and the cross section. So the depth at particular places across the channel. And from that, once we measure the velocity of water, we can calculate how much is the volumetric flow rate of water that goes through this cross section. So from that, we can calculate the volume of water. And this is how the measurements look like. But in recent years, we prefer not to do the measurements by ourselves because we cannot repeat that every 10 minutes throughout the whole season. So we use this automatic runoff meter, which we deploy in June once the rivers start to flow. And then we have to take it away in the end of September when rivers start to freeze over. And from this sensor, we get the information of the runoff in every 10 minutes interval throughout the whole season. So we just provide the information of the cross section, and this instrument, this sensor, measures the velocity of water that flows above it. Below you can see that the polar bear was taking care of it. He didn't touch the instrument. The meteorological station are not as lucky as flow meters, because usually the masts are very interesting for polar bears. So there is quite often when our equipment is destroyed by animals. I mentioned about piezometers. So these are the pipes that go into the ground. And in these pipes, we can measure the level of groundwater. And we also use multiple loggers, multiple sensors for a measurement of the water temperature and also water level, how it changes. It's these measurements are done in piezometers, in lakes, and also in rivers. We also measure the volumetric water content of the soil using such instrument as this. And once you're interested in more details of our results, I always invite to the papers that we produce on the hydrological measurements. Now, what's the groundwater amount? Where's the surface of groundwater? We also use georadars, and this is the radar that provides information on the structures that are below the ground, so something that we cannot see with the bare eye. But from that, we get information on the thawing, so the melting of water, and how much ground thaws, so we know where the permafrost is, because permafrost is frozen, it's underneath, but during summer, there is active layer above it. And the active layer allows water to infiltrate. That's why we're interested in such information. And for that, we use also multiple equipment. This equipment is for measurement of the temperatures of the ground. That is very important for hydrologists as well, but not only for hydrologists. We also use time-lapse cameras. So the cameras that stay in the field throughout the year and take images, because we have to take out the equipment before the freezing. We don't know what's going on in the rivers during the winter. And for example, we can calculate that using different hydrological models. That's something that we also do, but I'm not gonna tell you in details how the hydrological modeling looks like, but maybe in the future, if you'll be interested in scientific part of the hydrology, you may also know how the calculations look like. But from the calculations and simulations, we knew, for example, that in November there was a huge flood, but we didn't measure that. But from time-lapse cameras, we got the information that in the beginning of November, everything was completely frozen and covered with snow. But just in a few days, there was huge thaw, lots of precipitation, and big flood in the catchments. So here is also information on the active layer. We know that in the 80s, the ground was thawing up to around 3 meters. In recent years, we observe the ground thaws up to 7 meters. And this provides also the space for the groundwater to float, increased infiltration. And recently, we also use drones. With the drones, we can do the precise measurements of the river channels, how they were changing, how the ground surface is changing, how much snow is stored, how much is melted away. So there is multiple information that we get in bigger areas using this very precise drones with very good cameras. One of the cameras that we use is thermal, so we know what's the temperature of the ground and the water, as you can see on the image on the left. And we also get the information on soil moisture and also on vegetation from multispectral camera on the right. So there is lots of information that I would like to share, and this is something that I do via my publications that I have with my colleagues from different countries. And that's something that I can just invite you to check, because there is no time to go into details of every publication, but I hope that you not only go through media that sometimes gives the fake information, but once you go to the scientific papers, there will be proof for the things that we observe. So, for example, we observe a higher rainfall and less snowfall in Hornsund. What we also observe is that the activity of rivers is much longer than in the 80s, and that's something that also is very interesting for us, because the longer the river is active, the more water will infiltrate and penetrate the ground. So it influences the ground, also the glaciers, and also vegetation, and also fauna, for example, reindeers, and also all the wildlife that appears in Svalbard. And for that, we also observe that there's more often rain on snow events during winter. We observe earlier snowmelt floods, higher precipitation in the autumn, and prolongation of hydrologically active season of the rivers in the Arctic. So that's something that I want to share with you. And just to show you some conclusions, the prolongation of the hydrologically active season is observed by the scientists that put their efforts to understand the impacts and consequences of climate change. And Arctic regions are highly impacted by the ongoing climate change. And this influences various environmental aspects, such as hydrology, snow cover, ground temperatures, wildlife, sea ice, glaciers, and everything you can see on this image.